This is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Alexandra King of CNN Digital. How do you hear me?
This is Alexandra King.
I have you loud and clear. How are you doing today?
Hi, Facebook. I'm Alexandra King, and I'm currently sitting safely on the ground at our studio here at CNN in New York City. But I am delighted to introduce you to astronaut Peggy Whitson, who's with us live from the International Space Station. Thanks so much for joining us, Peggy. So, Facebook, please do start sending in your questions for Peggy.
Oh, it's a thrill to join you guys. We have a lot of fun up here, and we want to share some of that.
So Facebook, please do start sending in your questions for Peggy. And in the meantime, just in case you need an introduction, you're looking at the official US record holder for most cumulative days in space. That's a record that Peggy broke last week. Today, Monday, is Peggy's 541st day in space. And right now, she's the commander of the International Space Station, something she's now done twice, again, smashing a new record as the first ever woman to do so. Peggy, you're such an inspiration. How does it feel to have spent more time in space than any other American astronaut?
Well, it's actually a real huge honor to represent all of NASA, because without all the people of the team working together to make this happen, it is impossible for any one person to hold this record. And so it feels very special to represent the NASA team that makes spaceflight possible. And so I'm honored.
We've got lots of questions coming in already. If you haven't already submitted yours, type it in the comment section below. The question that we have here is from 11-year-old Nehemiah Chavers. What are the education paths I should pursue now if I one day hope to become an astronaut or work in astronomy?
Well, that's simple. Any field of math, science, or engineering is an important field to contribute to the spaceflight and space exploration of any kind. And so I would encourage you to pick one of those fields that really drives you, that really stimulates you to do better and to learn more and really go after it and pursue it. And I think you will become anything that you can dream about. I certainly have, and I feel that it's possible for anyone who works hard and puts a lot of effort into it, they can do that.
Peggy, tell me, can anything really prepare you for life in zero gravity? What's that actually like?
Well, actually, life in zero gravity is hard to simulate. We practice on the ground what we call the day-in-the-life simulations, but it's just practicing some of the tasks. It can't prepare you for the fact that all of your tools float. If you don't pay attention to where they are, they're going to float away. If you don't Velcro things down, they're going to float away. And, you know, it's just incredibly disorienting to be able to work in any orientation. So I can work on the ceiling, or I can work on the walls and be equally comfortable in any of those orientations. But it does cost you in the sense that you have to keep track of your tools and all the things around you. So everything has to either be taped down or Velcroed down in order to keep track of it.
We've got a question now from Genia Glover. She asks, what do you believe is the single most important advancement we've gained from our time in space to date?
Wow, that's a deep question. Single most important advancement. There are just so many to choose from. I think probably, you know, the discoveries made by Hubble Space Telescope have been very dramatic, very amazing. I can't discount some of the discoveries made on Mars. I think that being a future destination, those are important discoveries as well. But I actually feel that the International Space Station is a critical stepping stone, and the research that we're doing here is going to help take us to those distant destinations and further explore space. So things like our technology development, where we're working on a closed-loop life support system, trying to get that perfected so that it'll work high fidelity when we go on those long exploration missions and we don't have resupply capability from the Earth. Studies looking at all kinds of things. We are looking at bone cells, bone growth, exercise requirements are necessary to minimize those losses. You know, are there drugs that we can take that would minimize those losses? So there's lots of really interesting research. It's hard for me to pick just one. You know, all of them are fun to do. We're growing cabbage. Now it's called Chinese cabbage. It's more like a lettuce. And even though we're doing scientific research on it, we get to harvest it to eat every once in a while. And that's a lot of fun for us as well. And it's important, again, for those explorations in the future. So, again, I think Station is a fantastic stepping stone to get us there.
A more personal question now from Tanya Thompson, who asks, do you get to communicate with loved ones? And if so, how often?
Well, actually, here in low Earth orbit, while we're going around the planet, 250 miles above the Earth, 17,500 miles an hour, so every 90 minutes, we're going around the Earth. And we can actually use an internet protocol phone because we have the appropriate satellites that can get those bandwidths down, and we can call home from here. So I talk to my husband pretty much every day. I talk to my parents and my family probably once a week at least, and friends all the time too. So communication now is not difficult. I think those future exploration missions where we're not going to have that immediate comm capability because we're going to be going such distances that it's going to take minutes, literally up to maybe 20 minutes for a message to get one way to Mars. So it's going to be a dramatic change in our ability to communicate in those future missions. Right now, I think we've got it easy by comparison.
We're sadly running out of time, but we've got time for one last question, a fun one. Marie Holmes wants to know, what's the first thing you want to eat when you get back to Earth?
Well, I told you we got to eat lettuce, but that's only a few leaves. We get to eat like a couple of leaves each every few weeks or so when we're growing it. So that's the one thing I miss the most is like a really fresh salad with lots of different vegetables on it.
Well, I very much hope you get that on your return. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but thank you so much, Peggy. It's been an honor chatting with you, and we wish you the best of luck with the rest of your mission.
Well, thank you very much. And please, all of the young people out there who are interested in math and science, please go after it, pursue it. We need more scientists and engineers to go take the next steps.